It almost took a year into his term before President Marcos finally appointed a health secretary. The prolonged appointment earned the ire of critics who questioned his administration's priorities. Rafael Bosano with this special report.
We continue to encourage everyone to get their booster shots in preparation for the resumption of in-person classes. So hindi na natin kakayanin ang isa pang lockdown.
Ferdinand Marcos Jr.'s election to the highest position in the land came with a rather heavy task to steer the country towards recovery from the COVID-19 pandemic. It is therefore no surprise that one of his first orders is to increase the public's booster uptake through the Pinas Lakas campaign. But reception was lukewarm and government failed to hit the target of booster vaccinations by his 100th day in office. Despite this, Marcos was adamant in easing pandemic restrictions and health protocols. And even with the ongoing global public health emergency, government eased face mask use and made it optional in both indoors and outdoors. By the end of 2022, President Marcos chose to no longer extend the country's state of calamity, which resulted in the delay of donations of bivalent vaccines, which work against the newer variants. Donations of 390,000 doses of bivalent vaccines only arrived in June. So far, only health workers and senior citizens are allowed to get the extra jab. For President Marcos, it remains clear that the COVID-19 pandemic is not the only health problem the country is facing.
The need for a stronger healthcare system is self-evident. We must bring services, medical services, to the people and not wait for them to come to our hospitals and healthcare centers.
For minimum wage earners like coachman Roderick Javier, falling ill is not an option.
Hirap ang magkasakit ngayon kasi sa hirap ng buhay. Kailangan lumalaban po tayo.
But improving the country's healthcare system and making these services accessible to the public entails increasing the number of medical workers. Health workers have also repeatedly called out the lack of a health secretary during an ongoing health crisis. So after almost a year in office, President Marcos finally chose his health secretary, an emergency doctor who has also served as a spokesperson of the National Task Force Against COVID-19.
With the installation of Dr. Ted Hagbosa as the country's health chief, he brings with him an 8-point agenda that will serve as a guide for the country's healthcare system. Its key trait, a humanistic approach in providing the public with essential healthcare services.
Hagbosa says his agenda aims to provide solutions to health-related problems faced by Filipinos.
Kailangan mo ng brain surgery, major heart operation, tutulong ang pamahalaan kung kulang ang pera mo. And that is the essence of universal health coverage. Na yung financially, yung mahihirap, hindi magbebenta ng bahay, ng lupa, ng kalabaw, ng hanap buhay.
Also part of his agenda is the use of technology for faster medical services, preparedness for any crisis, aversion to diseases, mental health, and the protection of healthcare workers. He also hopes to provide opportunities for underboard nurses to serve in public medical facilities to address the lack of nurses in the country.
Agree na si Secretary Laguesma sa idea ko at kakausapin niya raw ang PRC para mabigyan ng temporary license itong kategorya ng nurses na to. 4,500 vacancies ko, hindi lahat Metro Manila yon. All over the country yon. So pag napuno na siya, tigil na muna yung temporary license.
But the Professional Regulation Commission says there is no provision in the law that would allow this to happen. Hagbosa admits a lot of challenges are bound to come his way as the new health chief. Rafael Bosano, ABS-CBN News.
Heads of several government agencies highlight achievements during President Marcos's first year in office. The Migrant Workers Department says the president's first year already yielded solutions to long-festering problems affecting overseas Filipino workers. It adds the future of overseas employment looks bright because of that. Social Welfare Secretary Rex Gatchalian, meanwhile, says the state of the nation is healthy and strong thanks to Marcos's concern for the poor and vulnerable sectors of society. Trade Chief Alfredo Pascual also hailing Marcos for creating a conducive environment that enabled businesses to thrive and generate more jobs for Filipinos. As for National Economic and Development Authority Chief Arsenio Balisacan, he says the Marcos administration successfully navigated headwinds, but he admits there is still more work to do to attain the government's ambitious development targets. The Marcos-led National Innovation Council approves the National Innovation Agenda Strategy document. Malacañang says the roadmap outlines the Philippines' plan to improve innovation governance and establish what it calls a dynamic innovation ecosystem. It also provides innovation actors with necessary facilities and resources to transform their ideas into products and services. It also connects the entrepreneurs to potential investors and funders. The Innovation Council is composed of 16 department secretaries and 7 executive members from the private sector. President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. says he will not let the people's support for him go to waste as he returns to Davao del Sur, a province that delivered a landslide win in the 2022 presidential race. In a speech during the 56th founding anniversary of the province, Marcos said his campaign promises, including unity, are now being fulfilled. Marcos received 87% of the votes in Davao del Sur, which is the bailiwick of his vice president, Sara Duterte.
I am honored by all of you and those who came before you for having the heart to work together to turn the province into the peaceful and progressive place that it is today. Ngunit hindi ako makapagtuloy na hindi ko, on a more personal note, na hindi ko na paabot sa inyo ang aking pasasalamat sa inyong binigay na suporta, sa inyong binigay na tulong, sa inyong binigay na pagmamahal noong nakaraang halalan. Huwag sana po kayo magsawa at kami naman ang aming isusukli sa inyong pagmamahal ay ang aming pawis na hindi mauubos hanggat masasabi natin tapos na ang trabaho, hanggat masasabi natin wala nang gutom na Pilipino.
Meanwhile, Marcos also lauded Davao del Sur's peace efforts in addressing insurgency.
Let me acknowledge that this is the first province in the Davao region to be declared insurgency-free. Hindi maliit na bagay yan. At alam naman natin na ang kailangan upang tayo ay magpaganda ng buhay ng ating mga kababayan ay ang kapayapaan.
President Marcos is in Davao for the inauguration of a road segment and a ceremonial loan agreement for a transport project. Our correspondent Katrina Domingo joins us live for more. Kat, good afternoon. The latest from there, please.
Hi, Rica. President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. urged the Department of Public Works and Highways as well as the Department of Transportation to finish all projects on time. He gave that statement as he witnessed the ceremonial loan signing for Davao City's 73.4 billion public transportation modernization project. This is a major bus system project here in Davao City that is expected to procure some 1,100 buses as well as to oversee the construction of 3 terminals and 5 depots to provide a safe, convenient, and affordable mode of transportation in one of Mindanao's major commercial hubs. The president says that he assures Filipinos that his government is working hard to improve the country's transportation systems, operations, and management for the benefit of present and future generations. You see, Rica, in 2017, this bus project here in Davao City was initially worth 18.6 billion pesos, but that amount nearly quadrupled in 2023, this year, after the National Economic and Development Authority conducted a re-evaluation. We spoke to Transportation Secretary Jaime Bautista earlier, and he tells us that the significant difference in the amount of the project was due to the was due to the procurement of additional buses for the system. He tells us that in the initial project, the procurement of buses were not yet included, but then they had to add in the cost to make sure that there would be a seamless operation once this is launched later this year. Now, aside from the event here in Davao City, the president also oversaw the inauguration of the first phase of the Davao Coastal Bypass Road. That's a 17-kilometer project, which is expected to ease the traffic congestion here in Davao City. The president also attended the founding event of the Digo City earlier this morning, where he celebrated with his constituents there, saying that his administration would always extend help for the people of Digos as well as other Mindanaoans. Now, Rica, the president is expected to fly back to the capital city later this afternoon. We spoke to his sister, Senator Aimee Marcos, who is also here in Davao City, and she told us that there will be a celebration in Malacañang later this evening for the advanced birthday celebration of their mother, former First Lady Imelda Marcos, who will be celebrating her 94th birthday tomorrow. Tomorrow, on the birthday of Imelda Marcos itself, on Sunday, the family is just expected to hold a private celebration. Rica.
Thank you so much, Katrina Domingo, reporting live from Davao. Philippine human rights defenders head to Geneva, Switzerland, to personally urge the United Nations to launch a new probe into human rights violations in the country. The Philippine Universal Periodic Review, or UPR Watch, flagged continuing abuses amid a worsening economic crisis under the first year of the Marcos administration. In a statement, the group said the continued attacks on basic democratic rights are what fueled them to make the call. It also raised the absence of significant measures to address deeply rooted economic problems, such as wages, poverty, and poor health services. The Philippine Economic Team holds its first interagency summit on a proposed Military Uniform Personnel, or MUP, pension reform bill. Present at the summit were senior non-commissioned officers, including from the Philippine military and police. It's part of an information drive of economic managers to discuss the proposed changes in the MUP pension system.
Ang layo na ito para maintindihan yung mga reforma ng mga tropa natin sa baba. Kasi yung mga tropa natin sa baba, gulong-gulo sila about this reform. So yung iba dyan, nagpa-file ng optional retirement. Even without knowing what is reform is. Ito yung Military Uniform Personnel Reform, Pension Reform Bill. Ito yung magsha-share na ang mga MUPs ng para sa kanilang pension. So magko-contribute na sila. Dati wala po talagang ganun. The government is the one paying for the pension of the MUPs.
The Finance Department had pushed for the reform, with President Marcos also saying MUP pension funds can be depleted if changes are not made to them. The last drug case of former Philippine Senator Laila De Lima raffled to another court in Muntinlupa City. The transfer was made weeks after the previous judge, Romeo Buenaventura, inhibited from the case. De Lima's co-accused had asked for Buenaventura's inhibition. They pointed out that the judge's brother, attorney Emmanuel Buenaventura, had previously assisted De Lima's co-accused, Ronnie Dayan, in executing a discredited affidavit. The court that has taken over De Lima's remaining case had acquitted her of another drug charge in May. De Lima's trial will resume with the new presiding judge on July 7. The new judge is yet to be named. The Philippine Anti-Graft Court hands another conviction to the detained businesswoman at the center of the so-called pork barrel scam. The Sandigan Bayan on Friday found Janet Lim Napoles and several others guilty of graft, malversation, and bribery. Napoles and her co-accused are tagged in the misuse of development funds allocated to lawmakers. The court also convicted former Davao del Norte Representative Arel Olaño. Napoles, Olaño, and two others were charged with diverting over 7 million pesos of development funds to non-existent projects in 2007. The Sandigan Bayan had sentenced Napoles last month to up to 54 years in prison. She was found guilty of the misuse of some 15 million pesos of development funds of the late Davao del Sur Congressman Douglas Cagas. A former Philippine mayor found guilty of malversation of public property involving 14 unaccounted Armalite rifles. Ex-Puerto Princesa City Mayor Edward Hagedorn was sentenced on Friday to imprisonment of 2 to 7 years by the Sandigan Bayan 3rd Division. He is also perpetually disqualified from holding public office and is required to pay a fine of the amount he malversed plus interest. A 2016 complaint lodged against Hagedorn claimed the former mayor failed to turn over 14 of 20 rifles issued to him during his term. The firearms are worth nearly ₱500,000. State volcanologists record a significant increase in the Mayon volcano's activity. FIVOLC says it recorded 65 volcanic earthquakes as early as 5 a.m. Saturday from just 2 in the previous 2 days. It also noted an increase in sulfur dioxide emission and a series of ash and debris flow after 4 lava domes collapsed 4 kilometers from the Mayon's crater. Despite the increased unrest, FIVOLC says the volcano will remain under alert level 3, but it urged residents living within the 7 to 8 kilometer extended danger zone to be prepared to evacuate.
Right now, it's still following the template of the 2014 event, meaning effusive eruption. So again, we're evaluating this on a day-to-day basis. And if there are abrupt changes in the abrupt and sustained changes in the parameters, then we have to raise it to alert level 4.